Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
I'd like to welcome each and every one to this morning's meeting in our new Commissioners Meeting Room. It's been updated, I think, for the first time in about 30 years. So I think we have a nice look. I think there's a little bit more to be done, but it's very, very attractive, and we'll thank the staff for their work on that. Before we get started with the agenda, I'd like to call on Commissioner Vaughn for our invocation.
As you know, I enjoy and like to invite pastors, ministers to our meetings, and it gives me great pleasure, and it is an honor to introduce to you, and I'm sure he doesn't need an introduction, Don Carter from Baptist Temple.
Let us pray. Our Father, our nation was born in the spirit of prayer as men sought the wisdom of God. The founding of this great nation and down through its history. In good times and bad times, we have sought divine guidance. This morning, our fathers, we meet here, we pray for wisdom, because you've asked us and you've told us that if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth liberally and upbraideth not. You've also said, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. We're glad that this nation is a God-honoring nation. We ask you this morning to bless each person gathered here for the business at hand. We pray for wisdom and discernment for all those who are involved. May thy will be done, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Carter. We have Representative Boorstin with us this morning, and Mayor Wall. Welcome both of y'all. Mayor Herring from Swepsonville, good to see you. The first item on the agenda is public comments. We have one gentleman signed up for that, Brian Ewan. Mr. Ewan?
Where have you been?
It's been a number of years since I've spoken in public and in front of this board. I only recognize a few of you who's left over when I was here last. And I only found out about this ordinance 45 minutes ago. So I had 45 minutes to write this, get my clothes on, and come over. So I don't mean any disrespect in the way I'm dressed. But at the risk of becoming a gadfly, I'd have to take umbrage with the proposed ordinance on filmmaking. According to Times News, your proposal will require filmmakers to provide a script of the seconds to be filmed at a county facility and general description of the content of the film session. The county will not approve a request that promotes inappropriate behavior or has negative connotations. My problem with this, I have other problems, but my main problem with this is that it clearly violates the First Amendment regulation of content of speech. The U.S. Supreme Court has ruled in Joseph Burstein versus Wilson that filmmaking is an art worthy, or is an art form worthy of the First Amendment protections. The court has also routinely held that restrictions on the First Amendment speech be held to a four-part test limiting restrictions to time, place, and manner only. One of the tests of a restriction on free speech is that it be content neutral. How can this board declare that this ordinance will be content neutral when they're requiring filmmakers to make their scripts available to the county for approval, and you add that the film cannot have negative connotations? I feel that this ordinance not only infringes on the content, but also unduly causes prior restraint on speech. I feel that any good attorney could get this ordinance overturned, causing cost in litigation to this county that we cannot afford. Not to mention it becoming yet another intrusive law poking holes in our First Amendment protections and chasing potential filmmakers away. I ask that the commissioners table this ordinance give clearer meaning to what you are proposing to do with a keener eye in protecting free speech. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Brian. Brian, do you want to respond to that anyway?
Certainly. I think the county and our department is, we've been approached several times about information out there, particularly about the people down in the city of Rockport. There's no desire from our department staff to tell folks what they can or cannot put into their proposed films. We have some concerns to make sure that activities, particularly the City Rock Park, are as appropriate as they can be. We don't want certain types of activities to take place in the park.
There are some things that are against our ordinances, period. Nudity, things along those lines. And we would like to ensure with this policy, and what we did is check with several other departments around the state, several of the county recreation departments, as well as state parks. And this is a rather typical policy for rec departments or counties or cities to have when it comes to filming in parks. And up till now, we haven't had an official policy. And as we get more and more requests, we wanted to be able to tell any contractor that asks us, here are the rules. We wanted to ensure in this policy, too, that costs to the county are covered. A lot of times these film makers need to have staff. We must have staff in the park while the film's being produced, so we would like for the contractor to cover those costs. So I certainly wouldn't want it to come across as county staff trying to intrude on people's First Amendment rights. But I think there is a level of behavior that we would certainly deem inappropriate and probably would not want to be taking place at Cedar Rock Park, even in the name of film. So. Okay.
From a legal perspective, Clyde or David, is
see no, sir, I don't
have issues with them?
I think Brian covered it pretty well.
Okay, thank you. Representative Borston, I mentioned that she was here. She would like to appear before us for a matter.
Thank you, Chairman Sharp, and hello, members of the
welcome.
Good morning.
Nice to see you. I'm doing fine, thanks. I hope you all are. And I'll be brief. I need your support if this project suits you. It's a project that should cost the county nothing. I need simply authorization from you, a resolution and a letter of support that would enable me and Senator Forrest to go ahead with competing. We're trying to elbow our way into some very small pots of money that are open for competition among counties for a very small road project. It is the paving of 2 feet on either side of 119 as it goes from Mebane north up to the county line. 2 feet on either side have been priced out at $1.4 million. There is no money at this point for a $1.4 million project to pave those two strips. It's not as wide as we would need for a full bike path, but it would accommodate bikers. It would accommodate walkers and hikers in that part of the county. We have the possibility of competing for some money from six small discretionary pots. The chances of getting the money are not great. But I have to have authorization from you to be able to go in and compete for those six pots. So that's basically it. I know that you're aware of the work that I've been trying to do to help Pleasant Grove find ways to open itself up, accommodate soft travel and tourism, weekend travel and tourism, create access to the Duke property, the Okanichi Saponi, the wineries, all those things in a manner that is not inconsistent with our watershed areas, the natural filtration area that we have in that part of the county that restricts our development. So this seems to be compatible. It also meets some needs that we have for extra recreation, for health things, for economic development, all of those. So that's it in a nutshell. There's a draft letter that I sent over and a draft resolution. If you are comfortable with my going after this money, you could either authorize and sign that resolution that I sent or fix it up and make it a little bit better. I'm not offended.
Okay. We have any discussion on this?
The Recreation and Parks has been working with the Duke properties.
Yep.
To help us get some recreation and entrances and parking out there. So any help we can get in that, we'd appreciate.
And this should dovetail. I've been trying to do what I can do to make sure that that connection with Duke Forest stays there, because every now and then they tend to go away.
Yeah.
And they change personnel. But that connection gets remade, and Mr. Haygood has been brilliant working with, I think, a fairly difficult organization. But it looks like that's going to work. And I think this, if we can get the paving done on the sides of 119, that should dovetail perfectly with those projects, because people could get there by bike. People could get there. There are a lot of activities in that area that one could visit and make use of, and there's a good possibility for a good folk festival or cultural festival to be held there annually. And you could do it on foot or on bike. So there are a lot of things, a lot of benefits we could get from this. As I say, I'm not putting my bets on this money, but I'm certainly willing to get in there and make the proposal. The proposal has to go in on Thursday. There's some coordination. Some pots are not available at this coordinated meeting. Senator Forrest will make his proposal, which will be identical to mine, on the Senate side. But we both have to get our proposals in Thursday. I just learned about the deadlines earlier, last week. So that's the hurry.
I think this certainly appears to work well with our Recreation and Parks Department. Do we need a motion?
Yes.
So move.
Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Motion and second. Any further discussion? Not all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you very much.
Good luck.
Thanks a lot. And
Mr.
maybe.
Chairman, you have the original there. If you want to sign it and pass it around, representative can take it with it.
Okay.
That would be perfect. And that's signing the resolution and the letter.
I didn't have the letter. The letter has got the resolution.
I have a copy of the letter, but I think it might be. Shall we just fax that back? Well, that doesn't work so well.
Could it be printed?
I do, but it is.
Is it on email? I mean, can you print it on?
No.
Letterhead or someone right now?
Yeah.
Could Doc do that?
It takes the body of the letter plus the grading. But don't
do
this part. Excuse me for
bypassing. Sports, I'm gonna give you my phone number, please. If you'll call me about something I want to speak with you about.
Okay.
Please. It's not board related. Thank you very much.
And I'll let you know what happens.
Thank you.
I'll wait for everything. I'll just hang around back here.
Okay. Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Good luck.
Thanks.
Next on the agenda is a public hearing on the subdivision ordinance waiver request.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners.
Good morning.
What you have before you this morning is a subdivision waiver request. The applicants are requesting a waiver from the Alamance County Subdivision Ordinance, specifically sections 66.1. which is in regards to street frontage, and 66.512, marginal land. Those two respective sections of the ordinance in regards to street frontage, there is a requirement of a minimum of 60 feet of road frontage for all new lots. And marginal land, there is a requirement of 30,000 square feet minimum outside of any lot that has marginal land, such as floodplain. This particular property is located off of Oak Ridge Drive, and this is kind of a unique request in the fact that this is actually an island in the Hall River. Property is identified on tax map 9, block 8, lot 1F. It is not in a watershed, and it does have floodway on the property. As a matter of fact, the entire lot is covered with floodway. The applicant's intent is to subdivide about 6 acres off from the island and to sell that to another gentleman, Joe Jacobs, who would be using this as a personal campsite. Mr. Jacobs runs a canoeing company and takes paddlers down the Hall River. This would allow for be used as a site where canoers could come off of the river and go around the dam. And I've got some photos here to show you. That might help a little bit when you look at the site plan that's with your packets. The applicants have proposed to put in the 6-acre lot in a conservation easement, which would prevent there being any construction of buildings on the property. And also they are proposing to build pedestrian or to grant pedestrian easements as well to allow for paddlers to come off of the river and then go over the dam and relaunch from there. I've been told that at the planning board meeting that the applicant does not intend to use this as a launch site. They just intend to use this as an area for people to come off the river and continue their paddle down the river. Anyhow, just to show you a couple of pictures here. When you come to the property, this is the actual the stone wall as identified on your plat that goes out to the dam. At this time, Mr. Chilton, who is here to answer questions as well, has this gated off and with barbed wire and locked to prevent people from going out there. This is the actual stone wall, and this is the point of concern to the applicant for paddlers coming off the river. If standing facing this to the right, it's about an 8-foot drop down to the ground, and to the left it's about a 12-foot drop. And there's a better photo here in a second to show that. This is the actual dam if you're coming down the river. And as you can see, there's debris and rocks and all on the other side. And this is actually standing on the wall. And with that ladder, in between each rung is approximately a foot. So that kind of gives you an idea. That's about 11 feet or so going down. And that's one of the closer points. This is the section coming down the Hall River where paddlers would actually get out before they ever get to the dam. They would come out about in this area here, and the next photo shows you're looking back towards the mill, which you can't really see in this photo, but directly ahead, if you're standing there, you're going straight out to where the wall is at. Okay, that's all the photos that I have. I will say also that the planning board at their last meeting voted unanimously to recommend approval of this request, and I will be glad to take any questions from the board at this time. And I know that there are some citizens here that are here to speak as well, and I distributed before the meeting to each one of you a petition that I received on Friday with the signatures of approximately 15 residents in the area that were opposed to this request.
Okay, this is a public hearing. Is anybody here would like to speak to this matter? Yes, sir.
Commissioners, my name is Mark Chilton, and I'm here on behalf of Swepsonville Hydro LLC, the owners of the property. I am one of the owners of the property, that is to say. And I want to elaborate on the staff's presentation just to make really clear that the intention in the here is not to allow the public to access through the existing residential subdivision to the river. That is right now a private access point only. It crosses Mr. Wyrick's land, and I don't have any legal authority to let anybody. I have an easement that allows me to go across there, but I don't have any legal authority to let anybody else go across there. So it's what we're proposing is that when people to create a situation with the easement, that we would give an easement across my property only, and that it would allow folks who have put in at Swepsonville Park to paddle down to the dam, as they sometimes do now, go fishing, what have you. And instead of necessarily having to turn around there and continue and paddle back upstream to Swepsonville Park, they could carry over the dam and put back into the river and paddle on down to Saxbahaw. That's all that the public easement would allow. So there would be no additional access through anybody else's property or through anybody's neighborhood. But it would take what is currently a very dangerous situation where people sometimes do trespass across my property and climb down that ladder and continue on, and create the opportunity for them to go down the river and do it in a way that's lawful, and do it in a way that's reasonably safe. And at the same time, and we would be offering to dedicate that easement and to build the steps at no expense to the county taxpayers. At the same time, it would allow, and sort of in exchange, what we would be getting out of it is the opportunity to divide off this 6-acre island and sell it to Mr. Jacob, who would like to be able to use it as a destination that he would go to. But he would go there from Saxbahaw, so he would put in the downstream end of the island is in the backwater of the Sellers Manufacturing Company dam there at Saxbahaw. So people would be able to, or he would be able to paddle up to the island and use it for strictly recreational purposes. We believe that this waiver is very appropriate for two reasons. One is that the rule about marginal lands is intended to ensure that building lots that lots that are created are useful lots, and that they don't cause problems within the floodway. Well, when you look at the limited purposes for which we intend to, Mr. Jacob intends to use the lot, it is a useful lot. It's not, granted, nothing can be built on it in terms of a building, but that's not his intention. That's not his desire, and we would be recording a conservation easement on the plat that would make it very clear that no one would ever be permitted to build anything there. You'd have to be a fool to want to build something there anyway, because it's be washed out in a tropical storm or what have you, for sure. And we would also at the same time be recording a conservation easement on the rest of the land that we would be keeping. So the entire property would be under the conservation easement, not just the island that gets divided off. All or virtually all of both lots are in the floodplain or in the regulatory floodway. Probably almost all of it is in the floodway. The only thing that we want to be able to do at Swepsonville Hydro is to maintain the ability to maintain and the existing buildings and dam structure and associated sluiceways and what have you, for the purpose of potentially at some point in the future renovating the hydroelectric facility and bringing that back online. And so that's what we're trying to do here. We see it as a win-win-win situation. The county gets a significant improvement to its recreational facilities, gets to take better advantage of the Hall River for tourism and recreation. Mr. Jacob would be able to buy the island and use that for his purposes with, you know, no environmental impact. And we at Swepsonville Hydro would be able to create a safer situation on the property and also maintain our ability in the future, our opportunity in the future to develop the property into a hydroelectric station.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Anybody else like to speak to this? Yes, sir.
My name is Beeman McKinley Wyatt Jr. I own the property that they would be going through. The public road stops at my property, and it's a private access. Any access to this property and to his hydro plant would go directly through my property and down the road to my neighbor, Mr. Edwin Israel. Mr. Israel maintains the bottom half of the road, top half of the road I put asphalt on, and it's mine.
Is that coming from the cul-de-sac up at the top?
Public road, public support ends at the cul-de-sac.
I see.
Anything out there is
yours.
Is mine. Okay. Yes, sir. And it can't maintain a lot of traffic. He's addressed very well that he doesn't intend to send traffic in and out of my property. Let me also add that I have absolutely nothing against anyone canoeing up and down the Hall River. It's a beautiful place. I'd like to see, you know, they're welcome to enjoy it. Myself and the other residents of Woodside are very concerned that it will increase traffic flow and turn our properties into a tourist destination. and that's our main objection. There's also the safety issue of whoever's spending time down on the island. That water comes up pretty quickly at times. It's not very far above the floodplain. And I would have the question of sanitation. Where are these people going to use the bathroom when they camp out there? What is that addressed? And that's about all. We're a quiet neighborhood. We just want to keep it that way.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Anyone else like to speak? Yes, sir.
My name is Dean Wark, his brother, of course, and I live right next to him on the same cul-de-sac in question here. And there is an issue with residents of our area. Actually, obviously, you've been provided with a petition that was signed by residents of the area. Woodside Drive, Woodside Estates and Oak Ridge Drive is a small subdivision with a street that comes off of Swepsonville Sachs Road. There are no white lines, no yellow lines. I mean, it's a neighborhood. And there's great concern among people in the neighborhood that any changes would commercialize our neighborhood. And I think the point that my brother raised about where the people that spend time and maybe spend the night or whatever on this proposed site going to be able to use the bathroom. There have been no buildings proposed, and there's no way that a port-a-john company could access this to, you know, to use the temporary type facilities or whatever. There's a lot of issues that haven't been addressed. I think that's one major one. And if people, you know, take a look at this proposal, there would be other issues that would be raised that have not been addressed.
Thanks, sir. Anyone else? Mayor?
My name is Raymond Herring. I'm here at Swepsonville, but I do support and ask for your support of this waiver. It's just an extension of the Hall River Trails right now. They put in at my point at the Elements Grievance and the Hall River, and there's nowhere safely to go. You go to the dam, then you've got to backtrack to the point, and then later. And you go down the Sachs Wall if you want to enter there. What we're looking and seeking for is the safe way to get over this dam. NIH has offered the way to do it at no cost to the county, no cost to us. And at no time has it ever been looked at, this location as being a place to put in. People traveling the Hall River will not even know how to get into the Woodside subdivision. That's not their purpose. Right now, they're putting in upstream, coming to the Swepsonville takeouts and taking out. If there was a safe way to do it, they continue on the Sachs Wall, which is a 6-mile stretch of deep water. It's good travel, good, safe, there's no rock. So there's multiple purposes here. You got upstream, you got a degree of the skill that you need. You get in at my point at Alamance Creek and Boylwood Road, you can cross the dam, and all of this is deep water. So I would ask that you support this, and I know there will be no impact or change in their lifestyle in Woodside. You have to work to get to Woodside, and these people are wanting to use the canoe accesses and travel the Hall River. That is not a point of entry. It will never will be, and will not be advertised as such. Is that right?
That's correct.
So I ask for your support. We need it. As you can see by the ladder, it's unsafe. Should there be an emergency, there's no way to get to it now anyway. So it's barbed wire off. I've seen in Vietnam there was less barbed wire in places I was than this is. So you just can't get there by accident. You got to work to get into this area. So I would ask that you support this proposal.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chairman, if I can add one thing. And I did not mention this before during the presentation, in regards to the questions on sanitation, what the applicant or what Mr. Jacob has proposed is, and I do not have a copy, I was looking in my file, they are actually, this is going to be a primitive camping site from what he has explained to staff, and they actually will use portable facilities similar to what the military uses in combat. These are literally, they fold out and they go into a backpack. And there are bags that are sold that something is put in that to solidify it, and then it can be disposed of safely afterwards. So I just wanted to add that. I did look to see if I had a photo of it, but I don't, and I apologize. But hopefully that'll clarify something.
Jason, can I ask a question? I understand these people's concern, mm-hmm. and you live near an area you will be concerned not only for as far as bathroom facilities, but leaving wrappers and foodstuffs and so forth. Has that been addressed or taken care of?
It really has. Nothing has been brought up of that in any of the meetings, but Mr. Chilton may be able to.
Sir, you were asking about trash, basically. Mr. Jacob is, somebody who takes the protection of the Haw River very, very seriously. It's his livelihood to promote tourism in Alamance County along there. So he is certainly somebody who's real dedicated to not leaving behind anything of that kind. Jacob and I, I bought the property about a year ago, and Joe and I, since I bought the property and we worked out this plan that we're bringing before you today, have both been working hard on picking up trash. There is actually a lot of trash that naturally accumulates behind the dam. I have half the Pepsi bottles in the city of Greensboro come down onto my property, and it's honestly a constant battle. But that is something that we're really trying to work on. And in terms of the access issues that the neighbors have raised, I apologize to the neighbors for the fact that I have not discussed this plan at all with them before. I didn't even think to, frankly, because I didn't think it affected them in any way. I can see now. I can see how it would raise some concerns for them. But honestly, my insurance company will not allow me to let the public come in through there. You saw I have no trespassing signs everywhere and barbed wire up in order to regulate that. And I have even less interest of letting the public come in through that property or come across my bridge and onto the vicinity of any of the hydroelectric works. I've got no reason to want anybody near there. Because it's a liability, it becomes a liability issue for me and for my insurance company. So we intend to tightly regulate and prevent public access through the property or past the mill or across Mr. Wyrick's property or through the Woodside neighborhood at all. I know this goes beyond the scope of your question, but while I'm at the podium, if you don't mind. And in fact, I think, in fairness, the neighbors would have to acknowledge that before I bought it a year ago, there was no fence. There were no or hardly any no trespassing signs. Only no trespassing signs or any controls at all that had been put up were not put up by the prior owner. They were put up by Mr. Wyrick. He was the policeman down there. Since the time that I've bought the property, I've tried my best to seal it up and prevent people from coming down there. There were folks who would turn up and trespass on Mr. Wyrick's property and on what is now my property to go fishing out by the river. We've done everything we can to stop people coming in through Woodside, but we recognize that the Haw River is a navigable waterway. It's a public right-of-way, and the public has a right to paddle down the river. So we're just trying to work with that reality.
Okay. Any other comments from the public? If not, we'll close the public hearing.
I'd like to ask him a question. How long have you owned the property? How long have you had the property?
1 year now.
1 year. And there's actually going to be a bridge going across?
There is a little bridge that goes out to one of the islands. The mill building was built between an island and the mainland. It connects between the two, and there's a little bridge that runs a foot pedestrian wooden footbridge.
I mean, are you building a new?
Okay. No, sir. We replaced a rotten old one with a current.
So if they get to that island, they got to come across that your bridge, don't they?
Only if they're trespassing, sir. Okay. And when they come down the river, they'll land on a little nub of land that you see on that survey, that's just above upstream of the dam. Mm-hmm. that the ownership of that little piece of property is unclear. My deed doesn't call for me to own that land. I think probably at the time that my deed was first written up, that piece of land didn't really exist. It's sort of
probably
accumulated.
Underwater at that time.
Yeah, I believe so, because the dam actually was a foot or two higher up until the 1970s. I think they had a wooden superstructure on top of the dam that's now gone, but we don't intend to bring that back or anything. They would land on that property, which I guess it must belong to y'all. It don't belong to me. It's part of the public right-of-way, essentially. And then they would cross over the dam right there, fairly close to the mill race and the clean-out, and climb down a set of steps and go along what's currently my property and back to the river. And that would be our plan. But they would not be allowed to come over to the mill building, over across the bridge, over toward Mr. Weirich's property or Mr. Israel's property. And it would be clearly marked what was the way through, and we would have signs indicating that, you know, the area outside of that little easement corridor is private, and that that there would be no trespassing.
Did anybody from planning go out there and look at it?
They did.
Yeah, you went. I did. I did not actually get out to the island, but I did go out to where the wall was at and look at where they were going to cross over. But I did go out to the
side. Sure. Nobody on the, you know, other than you.
Oh, on planning?
Yeah.
No, not to my knowledge. The mayor and I met out there, Brian Haygood, also.
I'll be honest with you. I'm just telling you how I feel. All this appears to be very murky to me. looking at it on a map, which is not easy for me to even decipher. I can't support this until I actually go out there and look at it myself and see the neighborhood and see what all the concerns are. That's the way I feel about it.
Okay. Public hearing's closed, sir. Unless somebody addresses a question to you. Okay. Does any other commissioners have any comment? If not, is there a motion to approve or disapprove? I'll make a motion that we approve the subdivision ordinance waiver request. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Is there a second? Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
No.
That motion carries. Okay, next is a proclamation for the World Elder Abuse Awareness Day. Ms. Parker.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I thank you for this opportunity to speak to you about this all-important subject. Each year, our nation pays tribute to the contributions of older Americans have made to our country, and even local communities come together to celebrate Older Americans Month. Unfortunately, while one segment is celebrating the contributions of our older adults, another segment totally disrespects the work and lives of our senior population. The sad fact is our senior citizens are abused physically, sexually, financially, and emotionally every single day. There is no limit to the range of perpetrators, from large corporations and paid caregivers to trusted sons and daughters. Elder abuse happens daily in our neighborhoods and in every geographic area without regard to income or social status. With more than 77 million baby boomers in the country aging, the instance of elder abuse is very likely to get worse. Here are some facts that we need to consider regarding elder abuse. Every 2.7 minutes, older adults are victims of some kind of mistreatment. Financial exploitation occurs more frequently than actual abuse, and neglect is the leading type of mistreatment reported and substantiated in this country. In 2007, in North Carolina, 47% of mistreated adults lived with family, and 31% lived alone. We believe the first step toward prevention of this type of abuse is awareness and acceptance that we do have a problem in our country. In light of the serious nature of elder abuse, you have in your packet a proclamation of World Elder Abuse Awareness Day. And we respectfully request that you accept this proclamation proclaiming World Elder Abuse Awareness Day in Alamance County, June 15th, 2008. Thank you.
Do we have a motion to accept the proclamation?
Second.
A motion that is a second. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Ms. Parker. Next, we have a request for a rate increase from our public waste services. Bo?
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners.
Good morning.
Today, they asked for a rate increase on the garbage fees of $1.49. Fuel, I know, has shot way up, y'all are aware of. Plus labor costs and a lot of other costs. And we'd like to have a $1.49 rate increase.
Is somebody here from, you're from the
landfill?
Yes, sir. Just a point of information, a couple of years ago, we had a little discussion about what percentage of garbage was going in our landfill from, I assume, the vendor here.
In terms of losing trash to
exactly.
The transfer station.
Yeah. Is that percentage where we want it?
Obviously, we would like to have all the trash. Currently, that's not the case. And that would be our request. From the landfill's perspective to receive that additional trash. I have some information here, Mr. Sutton, if I could.
Yeah, I didn't know you had all that.
I've got
because that was an issue not long ago.
We're at about a break-even point.
Yeah.
I know there's a balance you want to where you don't overload it.
Right.
And
this
so forth.
Is each respective hauler's territory.
Mm-hmm.
And I have the increase listed right here. And actually, their customer base is also there.
Once again, I apologize. How far away are we from having it where you would like it or where management thinks we ought to have it?
As far as Republic Waste is concerned in the residential, they're close. They're sending us a lot of their trash. I don't have the actual
right.
tonnages before me today, but I can get those. But obviously, you're right, we would like to have all the trash.
We're now making about 100 to 100, 200,000 over the break even. It's still taking money to run the landfill and prepare for the future. And it's up to y'all whether you want to increase it, but it was my understanding about a year or two or three ago, y'all decided for the county that so long as we stayed at a break-even point or somewhere close, that would be sufficient. Rather than trying to increase the amount of waste that we brought in.
Right.
Mr. Sutton, their commercial trash is actually where we're losing. Republic particularly is feeding their transfer station to Greensboro, so we're losing a tremendous amount of trash there. Not so much so on the residential. Probably, my guess would be around $700,000 a year. Through commercial hauling.
So with everything combined, we're where we're going to be.
I think so, yes.
Okay, that's my concern.
How about Waste Industries?
Are they here? Represent. They are, Mr. Sharp, they are sending most, if not all, their trash. There may be about 50 tons a day that we're missing, but they're supporting this county.
You have to say that the 50 tons of these make reference to are tons that can't go out of this county. They're special waste that must be taken to a special facility.
Waste Industries did call, but they did not get any request in on time, so we may hear from them later. I'm not sure.
y'all have plans for to request a rate increase also?
Yes, sir. We have sent a letter to Greg requesting a rate increase. It's been almost 6 years since we've asked for a rate increase. As you know, the fuel pricing has gone up tremendously. We anticipate an increase as a result of the Senate bill that was recently passed, the trash tax. We're just trying to pass on some of those costs to maintain a small level of profit.
That tax goes into effect July 1.
Yes,
is that correct?
Sir. Yes, sir.
And that is it that in our budget?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
It represents approximately a 5.5% increase in our tipping fees currently.
But we appreciate you use any influence you have to steer some additional tonnage our way.
Okay.
Do we have a motion on this?
Motion
to accept the rate increase. There's a second.
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 I would like to say, if we feel like that the imbalance is starting to go negative on our side, we need to be told immediately.
Yes, sir.
Please.
Yes.
In regards to the whole picture.
And there's a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Not all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Next to the appointment of the Union College Board of Trustees, we have two applicants. David Barber, who's currently on the Board of Trustees, has said that he would like to be reappointed. And then we have Derek Steed, who said if we would appoint him, he would be happy to serve. So we need to choose one. We'll just start with Mr. Barber. All in favor of reappointing Mr. Barber, just raise the hand, I guess. Okay. Three is a majority. Mr. Barber is reappointed. Okay. We have a budget amendment for the health department. Budget 170, Tim.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. I appreciate the opportunity to present this proposed budget amendment involving $605 additional funds from the North Carolina Department of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention. These funds will be used to support the Juvenile Crime Prevention Salary Coordinator for the remainder of the current fiscal year. Proposed amendment involves 100% state grant funds. There's no local matching required.
We have a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
Let me say that Tim is a short timer again. He'll be leaving July 1st. Or are you going to stay on and be a new guy?
I'll probably take a pass on this one. I appreciate the
we really appreciate what you're doing. And being on the health board, it's been a pleasure to serve with Tim through the years. He is he coordinates things, and he gets things done without creating a problem with the employees, and that is a good thing to have.
I appreciate
Greg Thomas is going to have him working down to landfill.
That's what I hear. I'm glad.
I'd like this.
It's like we're talking trash already. I don't miss the work. I definitely miss the folk. Certainly, health department employees and the county staff have the utmost respect, and including those before me. So we appreciate your support on this amendment.
Thank you, Tim.
Hey, we have a motion and a second in discussion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Mr. Manager?
Mr. Chairman, the only one matter at the last meeting or one other, I think we had a report concerning the collection of fees for the jail. And the sheriff, do you want to? How do we stand now on collection?
This month, and I figured it up yesterday, we should bring in over $500,000 just for 1 month.
And what about the pay from?
It's called up. I think May is the only one we have not received from ICE.
They were, I think ICE was behind 2 or 3 months, and now they're 1 month behind, and we expect them to stay at least 30 days back. So but the money is coming in.
Yes, that's good.
Being caught up.
Yes, ma'am. We made a phone call or two, and we had some help from somebody represents in Washington, D.C., but all I know is we got a message that the money come in immediately.
Senator Doe was here the other day.
I didn't say that.
That's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks, David. Thanks, sir. Next is the consent agenda.
Can I just have a little rebut from what was said earlier?
Well, go ahead. Go ahead, Brian.
Well, I just want to rebut what the gentleman said. He heard what I was talking about, but Phil. It really, in my opinion, shouldn't matter what other counties'
but ordinances are and things like that. This county, I would hope, would be the freest county, the least expensive county for filmmaking. Something that is more accommodating than all the other counties to draw the business here. And I think that's something that you guys should look at.
Yeah, we definitely want them to come if they want to.
Well, yeah, and that's what I'm afraid of. Is that, you know, I was really proud when
money in Alamance County.
I was really proud when I can't remember the two brothers were making the film downtown. We'd hate to, chase that kind of business away. You know, when they're making a horror film downtown, Graham. That's my concern, and also with the First Amendment problem that I see with it. I just wanted to rebut with what he is saying. Just it shouldn't matter what other counties do. It really matters what you do.
Thank you, Brother.
Does anybody want to pull anything out of the consent agenda? If not, I'll make a motion that we approve items A through E. Is there a second?
Second.
Before we vote, Ronnie, you're on the city council. Burlington. Mayor, if somebody approached, I remember when Bull Durham was filmed here in Burlington, at Burlington Athletic Park, you weren't on the city council then, but
he was one of those kids cheering them.
Would there not be a policy to review who was going to use the public facility? Like if somebody wanted to go to Burlington Athletic Stadium?
That's wrong.
I'm sorry?
Bones reviews every request from a filmmaker.
Yeah.
And they approve them individually. They don't have an overall policy, I would think.
Thank you, Mr. Sutton. There you go.
There you go.
I don't have a problem with having some control review ability of the process. And not to have anything, I think, would be worse than having something that we could overrule or discuss. So forth.
Yeah, you don't want porno in the middle of the county park.
Do what?
It's like you don't want porno filmed in the county park.
No, I don't.
And I agree with that part. I'm saying as far as the other issues.
But I do support some ability to analyze it, and I think this is setting that.
Me and that motion slightly is item A through H, not A through E. Okay, all in favor of the consent agenda say aye.
Aye.
All opposed.
Motion carries.
Any commissioners have any announcements? Not. Meeting adjourned. Thank you all.
1 day of each month in the Commissioner's Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m. and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Friday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 3 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.